The much-awaited report on the alleged involvement of top Philippine police officials in the illegal drug trade set to be submitted to Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos. Our very own George Carino now joins us with details on our top story. George, over to you. What more can you tell us about this developing story? Go ahead.
Hi, Casey. The Philippine National Police announced this morning that the final report of the five-man member advisory group is now set to formally endorse their report on the courtesy resignation of senior police officials. In a press release issued Friday morning by the PNP Public Information Office, it reads that the five-man member advisory group, which looked into the records and documents of the senior officers of the PNP, has completed evaluation and screening of 953 senior police officials who submitted individual letters of resignation in support of the massive internal cleansing program initiated by the Department of Interior and Local Government and PNP leadership. The advisory body convened on Thursday afternoon, 20th of April, which was yesterday, for the eighth time since it was constituted to determine the fitness of all senior officials to continue serving the police organization. The PNP says the advisory group's report is now set for submission to DILG Secretary Benjamin Abalos Jr., who is also the concurrent chairman of the National Police Commission, or NAPOLCOM. Subsequently, the report will be submitted for final review and approval of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Press release also conveyed the message of the chief of the PNP, General Rodolfo Azurin Jr., expressing gratitude to co-members of the five-man advisory group and support staff for the successful culmination of the evaluation and screening process of all 953 CERN level police commissioned officers. Easy.
All right, George, a couple of questions for you before we let you go. First off, we all know about the alleged cover-up that Secretary Benhur Abalos exposed to the public a couple of weeks back. Were the 10 officials tagged in that alleged cover-up part of this review conducted by the five-man panel?
Totally, that is a separate investigation being handled by the SITG, or Special Investigation Task Group 990, headed by General Eliseo Cruz.
We understand that, but were they also part of the 900 or so of officials who submitted their resignation, courtesy resignations?
You're correct, Casey. To be more precise, all senior officials are 953 in numbers. But if I'm not mistaken, some of them were able to reach the mandatory retirement age of 56. So as the period moves along between January 4 until yesterday, I hope I'm not mistaken that the number of courtesy resignations has gone down to 941 because of the mandatory retirement age of some officials. And according to Jenna Azurin yesterday, 917 has been declined as far as courtesy resignation are concerned.
All right. So now that this report is going to be submitted, how much of it will be available or will be made available to the public? How transparent will the process be from here onwards, George?
Well, reading from the statement provided by General Azurin Thursday afternoon, he said that when he retires by Monday, April 24, then that announcement will be left to the hands of the new leader of the PNP, who will succeed him.
Mm-hmm. And on that last one, do we already have a name as to the successor of General Azurin?
We were trying to interrogate General Azurin yesterday, Casey, but he wouldn't give in to media questions. On who is his likely successor, did he endorse anyone. He keeps on telling us, and he is quite consistent on that part, saying that he doesn't know who is his successor, and the only message he has to his successor by Monday is that to be strong in dealing with the tough job of being the chief of the PNP.
George, you've been covering this beat for quite a long time now. Is that regular? Is that normal that the outgoing PNP chief doesn't know who's going to replace him, hasn't been consulted about his successor?
Well, we all know for a fact that the usual line, that's the usual line of the police chief, that he doesn't know who is his successor. Well, we can always presume that he's one among those being consulted with the appointing authority, which is the president, on the next successor. And most likely, amid all the speculations, he's been consulted by the higher authorities, and most likely within the circle, unless he's not within the circle or has no direct line with the president.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Our very own George Carino there joining us on the line. Thanks, Manong George. Back here in the newsroom, the lawyer of the family of slain Governor Roel De Gamo backing the Justice Secretary in moving to designate Congressman Arnulfo Teves Jr. a terrorist. Teves is deemed the main mastermind in the killing of Governor De Gamo. The congressman has also been linked to several political killings in the province. Attorney Levito Baligor also says they have concrete evidence linking Teves to terror groups in Mindanao.
During the Senate hearing, Colonel Hansel Marantan requested for an executive session so he can divulge certain specific informations. Because what I can tell you now is that the signature of the IEDs recovered from the Sugar Central have the same bomb signature as that used by the NPAs and the other terrorist groups in Mindanao. Colonel Marantan is in possession of an affidavit of a former member of BIFF. That details the connection.
Attorney Baligod adds designating Teves a terrorist is a stronger approach in enforcing his return to the Philippines.
He is staying most of the time in Cambodia. Now, it would be very difficult for the Philippine government to take jurisdiction over his person because of that fact, not that legal impediment. For now, the Department of Justice is working on applying for a blue notice against Congressman Arnie Teves. Once he is in the blue notice, all countries will be duly notified and to monitor his activities and whereabouts wherever he may be. And once a red notice is, if he is included in the red notice already, then any country can effect arrest against him.
The new governor of Negros Oriental calls for the immediate resolution to what he describes as the dire peace and order situation in the province. Governor Carlo Jorge Joan Reyes says it must be addressed with a calibrated approach. This after Senator Robin Padilla suggested placing Negros Oriental under military control to address lawlessness in the province. Philippine Senator Francis Tolentino defending his proposal to suspend the upcoming village and youth council elections in Negros Oriental. Tolentino says this will allow authorities to have a firm grasp of the peace and order situation in the province and prevent more political killings there.
My purpose here is to, one, to have a breathing space, two, to really allow the parties to pull off, and three, to have a focused maintenance of peace and order for the forthcoming barangay elections in Negros Oriental. We don't want to take the risk. We don't want to have both parties coming up with something that would later on provide a means to sow threat and violence, and later on blame this on the PNP, the army.
The former Philippine prisons chief accused of ordering the murder of broadcaster Percy Lapid now allegedly willing to turn himself in. Jeff Caparas has the full story.
the merits of the cases.
Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla says former Bureau of Corrections Chief Gerald Bantag has sent surrender feelers to one of the cabinet members several days ago. Bantag, along with his deputy Ricardo Solueta, are facing two counts of murder for the separate killings of broadcaster Percy Lapid and June Villamor, an inmate who served as middleman in recruiting the gunmen.
He spoke to one of my colleagues in the cabinet to say that he may wish to surrender. That's why we are not pushing for law enforcement to hurry up the process. But of course, it is the job of law enforcement still to enforce the warrant of arrest.
Remulla adds, Bantag did not give any conditions for his surrender.
Alam mo, mahirap magtago. Mahirap magtago sa batas. It should be very difficult.
Remulla believed that Bantag is still in the country. A hold departure order was issued against Bantag after warrants of arrest were released by the Las Piñas and Muntinlupa RTC. The self-confessed gunman in the Percy Lapid killing, Joel Escorial, has been transferred to a more secure facility. After spending 6 months in detention at the Regional Special Operations Group at the National Capital Region Police Office in Taguig. From the NCRPO, he was brought to the PNP Custodial Center in Camp Crame in Quezon City. On Wednesday, a Las Piñas court granted the motion to transfer custody filed by RSOG Chief Police Lieutenant Colonel Wilfredo C. She argued, Crame can better ensure Escorial's safety, adding that they don't have a detention facility that is secure enough to protect a high-value inmate.
Well, it's a safe place, maprotektahan siya doon. And kung ano man ang plano sa kanya ng gobyerno to make him a state witness, doon ang pagdesisyonan. And likewise, mga lock-up cell lang kasi ang mga detention namin dito.
Escorial welcomes his transfer.
Mas okay ako doon sa ano, sa custodial. Mas safe ako doon.
Sa kami.
Opo. Kaysa dito sa kung saan ng mga facility. Kung doon ako mapunta sa ibang facility, sigurado mawawala ako sa mundo.
Dahil?
Marami na nag-aabang sa akin eh.
He also expressed regret over his role in the murder. Escorial also explains why he took on the job.
Yun nga siya, yung sinasabi niya na ayusin daw yung ano nila doon sa loob para mapabilis daw yung ano nila, paglaya.
He again pleads for forgiveness from the Mabasa family. And to make things right, he said he's ready to testify in court. Escorial will be temporarily detained in Camp Crame's custodial facility while the case is ongoing. Jeff Caparaz, ABS-CBN News.